We started talking last week about the specific characteristics in which we are to image God, because we've been in this series for now 6 weeks talking about the Imago Dei, the image of God within us, how God created us in his image, and then we messed that up, but now through Christ, we are remade into his image, and now God wants us to image him. He wants us to be like him in some specific ways. And we said last week, there's some ways we'll never become like God. We need to clarify that because we're not gonna become God when we get to heaven. God will still be God. We will still be humans. We'll just be perfect. We will be like God in some ways, but in other ways, we won't. We won't be omniscient. We won't be omnipresent. We won't, you know, have all those things, all the omnis of God, right? We're not gonna have those because that's still God. But we are going to image him in some specific ways. And so we said last week, we're going to look at four ways in which God wants us to image him. And we said last week, the first way is that God is others focused. He is three in one. That's the definition of the Trinity. One God, three persons. So God for all eternity was others focused. He's always been others focused. He's never not been that. I remember when I first trusted Christ when I was 12, and then I started like laying in bed at night thinking about God and realizing there's never been a time that God wasn't. And you start thinking about that, it like blows your noodle, right? Like things just start, because you just can't fathom that. Like, how has he always been? We just has. He's never had a beginning. He'll never have an ending. And so, therefore, he's always been there. And in his always been there-ness, that's bad English, but that's great theology, right? He's always been others focused. He's always been loving the other person of the Trinity. And so the very first way in which God wants us to image him is to love one another. In fact, that's what Jesus said in John 13. He said, this is the new commandment I give you, to love one another. And if there's anything that we need coming off of the week that has happened in America, it is that message, right? Love one another. So the only thing I'm going to say about that is regardless of how you voted, that really doesn't matter in the eternal sense, because we are Christian before we're anything else, right? And regardless of how you voted, we are called to love one another. We are called to love people who didn't vote like you. And that is probably the real test of love, right? Jesus says, it's easy to love those who love you, but if you love your enemies, that's tough. But that's how Jesus loved us, because the Bible says we were his enemy. We were his enemy, but he loved us. And so that's our call as Christians, to love one another. And that's how we image God. And what we're going to see this week is we're going to build on that, because love requires certain things. There is something that is so intimately connected in loving one another that you can't separate them. And so we're going to look this week at another characteristic about who God is and how it ties into how he wants us to image him. So if you have a Bible, we're going to be in two primary places. We're going to start out in John chapter 3, all right? John chapter 3, and then we're going to move on to 2 Corinthians chapter 8 and then chapter 9. I'm not going to do all of chapter 8 and all of chapter 9, so don't worry, right? But John chapter 3 is where we're going to start, 2 Corinthians chapter 8 and chapter 9. And I'm going to try to connect for you the idea of how love is really lived out, what is required for us to love one another. So look at this, John chapter 3, verse 16 and 17, arguably the greatest, most wide-known scripture in the Bible. I mean, people who don't even believe God, people who haven't even really read the Bible, have probably heard the scripture of John 3:16. When I was growing up, when I got saved, I was going to a small Baptist church in East Texas, and I played basketball in this group called RAs. Now, if you ain't Southern Baptist, you don't know nothing about RAs, right? It was Royal Ambassadors, which was kind of like a Christian version of Boy Scouts. And we had this pledge, as a royal ambassador, I do my best as a well-informed, responsible follower of Christ, I have a Christ-like concern for all people. You can tell I memorized it. But I played basketball in this league, and at halftime, we had to share memorized verses, and you could get an additional 5 points to your score. Straight up, this is how it happened. And the very first time we went out there, and I quoted John 3:16, and I got like 2 points for it. Like, man, I quoted that sucker. I'm like, well, everybody quotes that one. So then I had to memorize some other verses. And so I did, and tried to get the point up to 4 or 5, right? But this verse is arguably the most wide known, and I think for good reason. Because honestly, if you want to summarize almost the whole Bible, John 3:16 almost encapsulates it. Here's the message of the Bible. So let's read it. It says this, "For God so loved the world that he gave." God so what?
Loved
that he what?
Gave.
God so loved that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. And so in speaking of our call to love one another, because that images God, you see in this verse that God is ultimately motivated by love. He says, "For God so loved." Now this verse happened in a conversation that Jesus was having with a Jewish guy named Nicodemus. And Jesus was trying to explain to Nicodemus his whole purpose, what he was there for. And he was describing what it looked like to be born again. And Nicodemus is like, "How can I be born again? I can't go in my mother's womb again. That's not how this works, Jesus, right? I wouldn't fit anyway. I'm too big now. Like, what are you talking about?" Jesus is like, "I'm not talking about physical birth. I'm talking about spiritual birth." And he's giving him this context of saying, listen, the only way that you are born again is when you understand how much God loves you. God loves you. And that word love is the Greek word we looked at last week of agape, which just, let me give you that definition again, right, so that you can remember it. Here's the definition of this word love: to have a strong, non-sexual affection and love for a person and their good as understood by God's moral character, especially characterized by a willing forfeiture of rights or privileges in another person's behalf. So the definition of love, the definition of God-like love, is I'm foregoing my privileges, my rights for your benefit. We would call that sacrificial love, but I would say there's no other kind, right? Love is not a feeling, whoa, feelings. I don't sing good. My daughter tells me all the time, "Daddy, you preach, mommy sings." But love is, by definition, sacrificial. Love is not, "How do you make me feel?" Love is, "I'm going to forego how I feel for you. I'm going to give up my rights, my privileges for you." And that's how God loved us. And that's why Jesus says, "For God so loved that he gave." Now, let me give you the definition of gave. Very simply, to give means to sacrifice, to relinquish, to endure the loss of someone or something. Let me say it to you like this: you can't love without loss. Love, by definition, requires giving. And giving, by definition, requires sacrifice. So when I said there is no other kind of love, that's why I'm saying that. That is how God loved us. He loved us so much that he gave. So here's my first point, and then we're gonna spend the rest of our time kind of unpacking it, all right? So if you're taking notes, here's my first point. God is generous. God is generous in his nature, and we are called to image that in our nature. Let me say it again. God is generous in his nature, and we are called to image that in our nature. See, when I said for all eternity, God has loved the Trinity, God has been others focused for all eternity. What I mean by that is God has been sacrificing for the other for all eternity. So when God made the earth, it was natural for God. It was natural for him to create a human species, humankind, mankind, in which he would sacrifice for them. We need to know this about God. Because if you don't know this about God, then you think that Jesus was God's plan B. It's like God made the world, and then our first parents, Adam and Eve, right, messed it all up, and then the Trinity kind of had a huddle, like, what are we gonna do now? And Jesus is like, send me in, coach. Right? I'll go. That's not how this worked. Here's what would blow your mind. Before God ever made us, the Bible says he had already slain Christ. So here's the whole deal. God set it up so that he would have to give to us. That's how he set it up. It didn't catch God off guard. God is sovereign, and so God is not surprised by any election. God is not surprised by any action. God doesn't, you know, watch the earth and then the ticker on the bottom is like, what just happened? God never says, you know what I just thought of? You know what just occurred to me? He doesn't do that because he's God. He's sovereign. And so what I'm trying to get you to see is God in his nature is love. And since he is love, in his nature, he is generous. God had already decided before he ever made us that he would give us his son. Because that's his nature. God in his nature is generous. That is who he is fundamentally. So for Jesus to say that God so loved that he gave, Jesus is trying to say to Nicodemus, this is who God is. God is love. God is generous. Because you can't love without giving. You can't love without giving. You can give without loving, right? You can give out of guilt. You pull up to the red light, somebody's there holding a sign, you're like, dear God, here's a dollar. Because you feel guilty. So you can give without loving, but you cannot love without giving. You can't. But here's what I want you to see. Those who understand who God is, those who understand what God has done have no problem loving and have no problem giving. Because they know that the only reason that they can even give is because they have first received. They've received. And what did they receive? They received salvation. They received the Son of God. They received the love that had been poured out on them. And so when you see that, when you know that, when you understand that, guess what comes naturally to you? Generosity. You love and you give. And just to point this out, now move over to 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians chapter 8. Again, you shouldn't believe anything I say. You should test it with the Bible. Because all I ever want to say to you is not my opinions, but just the scriptures. But when you read the scriptures, it's all over the place. In fact, Jesus talked more about generosity than any other subject. More than hell, more than heaven. It's almost like he knew we needed to be reminded of this. He knew that we'd be so tempted to be like my kids. I've said this before, but I do this to my kids every day. And I did it to him yesterday when we went to Panera Bread for lunch. Every time we go to Panera Bread, you can't go to Panera Bread without getting a cookie. You know what I'm saying? Lindsay wants a Panera Bread here in Canton. I'm like, it would be better for my wallet if it wasn't. And so we go down to Woodstock. We go to Panera Bread. It's Natalie's favorite place. She gets kids mac and cheese, chips, chocolate chip cookie. And whenever we sit down at the table, I always get a piece of their cookie and eat it. Partly because I'm fat and I like cookies. Just being honest, right? But here's the principle behind why I do it. Almost every time I do it, my kids go, Dad, that's my cookie. Oh, it is? Who just bought that cookie? That cookie was given to you. And all I'm asking in return is a piece of it. I could eat all three of them if I wanted to. Because you ain't got a J-O-B. And now they've learned. But you know, I'm waiting for the day that we sit down and they tear a piece of the cookie off and just hand it to me. And say, Dad, thank you for giving me this cookie. I'm waiting for that day. It ain't happened yet. But I'm waiting. And here's what I'm getting at. When you know the grace of God, that he has given you gifts to enjoy. Why do I buy my kids cookies? Some of y'all would say because I'm a bad parent. But I buy them carrots too, right? But I buy them cookies because I want them to enjoy it. Because I get joy out of seeing my kids enjoy what I've given them. And so when grace is involved, when love is involved, it changes your whole perspective. And so where I'm getting at with this is when you understand the grace of God, you naturally become generous. And this is what Paul's going to argue here in 2 Corinthians chapter 8. So look at this, 2 Corinthians chapter 8, starting in verse 7. We'll work our way down to verse 10. Paul said this. He's writing to the Corinthians. He says, "But as you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in all earnestness, and in our love for you," listen to this, "see that you excel in this act of grace also. I say this not as a command, but to prove by the earnestness of others that your love also is genuine." See, Paul was writing to the Corinthians because they were taking up an offering for the Jerusalem church. They were taking up an offering, and he's describing to them that the church in Macedonia has already done this, and he's trying to get them to be generous. And so Paul is saying, I want you to excel in this. Excel means to have abundance, to increase in greatness. And he says, I want you to excel in this act of grace. Now, it's amazing when you look at that phrase, act of grace, it literally translates grace outworking. What he's saying is, I want you to excel in seeing that this is how grace works. This is how grace works itself out. Grace, when it comes to you, it works itself out in you being generous. He says, I want you to excel in that. I want you to see that the natural outflow of grace in your life is not just faith. It's not just you talk different, right? He says faith, speech, knowledge. It's not just that you know stuff. It's not just earnestness and love. It's also in this act of grace too, which this act of grace is actually what proves that your love is actually genuine. Because if you don't excel in this grace, then your love's not actually genuine. And then he says this. Here's the card. I would say trump card, but you might read into that too much, right? Here's the card that he throws down. Look at verse 9 and 10. He says, "For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ." You know it. You know it. And that means to know experientially. You've experienced it. This is not the know that means you know it mentally. This means you know it experientially. It's the love. It's the knowing that talks about spouses. You know this. He says, "You know the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ." Now listen to this. Here's the grace, that though he was rich, and that means in Greek, rich. It means materially wealthy. This is not a spiritual metaphor here that Paul's using. He's saying he was rich. The Old Testament says God owns a cattle on 1,000 hills. It's all his. It says, though he was rich, check this out. "Though he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, so that you, by his poverty, might become rich. And in this manner, I give my judgment." He's like, if you needed any conclusion to this, he goes, "This benefits you, who a year ago started not only to do this work, but also to desire to do it." What's Paul saying there? Paul's saying, listen, man, you know this. You know this. You know the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. And when you know the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, that grace is going to have an effect in your life. And the effect of that is it's going to prove that your love is genuine. Because the reason why you know God's love is genuine, because he gave. See, this is where we have conversations with people and we say, man, I just don't know if God loves me. And I get it, because you maybe have a hard time, maybe your parents divorced you or abused, some rough stuff happened in your life, and you're like, man, I just don't see how God can love. But here's what you can't say. You can't say God doesn't love, because the fact of the matter is in the middle of that circumstance, he gave Christ. Now, you may not see that yet. It may hasn't hit you yet. It may hasn't worked itself out in you yet. But you can never say that God doesn't love us because he gave to us. And in the giving, it proved the genuineness of his love. Are you with me there? So here's my second point. And you might want to write this one down. Love is not genuine if it is not generous. Love is not genuine if it's not generous. I could say all day to my beautiful 6-year-old daughter, baby, I love you. But if I'm not generous with her, then my love's not genuine. And I want to be clear about something, because the title of my message today is to be generous in every way. When I'm talking about generosity, I'm not just talking about dollars and cents. Because you want to know how kids spell love? They don't spell it L-O-V-E. They spell it T-I-M-E. Time. So you know what I have to give to my daughter in order for me to prove that my love is genuine? I got to give her time. But you know what? I don't want to give my daughter sometimes. It's time. And it's not because I don't love her. It's just because I want to go sit down on the couch. Any men going to amen me on that one, right? Yeah. In fact, this happened this last week. Lindsay was gone, and I was putting my kids to bed, and my beautiful 6-year-old daughter said, Daddy, can we read a book? I just want to go sit out on the couch because I need a break. But so you know what, baby? Yeah. So she's got this stack of books in the front of her bed, and she picks out this Bernstein Bears book, which I used to read as a kid. My mom used to read it to me. And just being honest with you, confession, I opened it up and there was a lot of words in it. So I said, baby, how about this book? If you give a moose a muffin. A lot less words. So, okay, Dad. So he sat on the bed, laid down, and we had gotten it from Chick-fil-A in our many kids' meals from there. And I read her, if you give a moose a muffin. And we read through it, and I gave her time. Because it was in the time of me laying down with her, reading a book to her, that she knew my love for her was genuine. Because I was generous with my time. See, it's not just money. But it's not less than money. Because I also have to buy my daughter stuff. And food. And my son, who's now 12, handsome young man. Moments after we feed him, he's hungry. And what I want to say to him is go get your BB gun and shoot something. If you hungry, sucker, go do what they did 100 years ago. Go kill your meat. But I don't say that. Why? Because I want him to know that I love him. And so my son doesn't spell food so much, or love so much as T-I-M-E, but F-O-O-D, food. He knows I love him because I feed him. And I don't scheme to take his food from him, even though I used to when he was younger, but now I'm fat and he needs it. And so. But you see what I'm saying here? Love is not genuine if it's not generous. And Paul is making the argument that you know God's love is genuine because God was generous. And he was generous by giving his son. Which anybody who has kids knows, I would rather give you every dime I have than giving you my kid. I'd give you everything. I'd give you my house, my cars, my bank account. I'd give it all to you if I could just have my kids. But God said he's so generous that he gave his son because his love is so genuine. And now we look at that and we think, okay, if that's the nature of who God is, then that's how I'm supposed to image him. Now flip over to 2 Corinthians chapter 9. One chapter over. This is why I love Paul. Paul just breaks it down for us. Verse 6 of chapter 9 of 2 Corinthians, listen to what Paul says. He says, the point is this. Here's the point. Whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And whoever sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Verse 7, each one must give as he has decided to in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. You know what Paul's saying there? You got to decide what kind of giver you're going to be. What kind of giver are you going to be? Are you going to be a reluctant giver? I'll do it because Jason made me feel guilty today. Right? Are you going to be a compulsion giver? You're doing it because of pressure? Or are you going to be a cheerful giver? Because there's only one of those that God loves. Now, that word cheerful literally is the Greek word hilaros. It's where we get our English word hilarious. When's the last time that you gave so much that it was hilarious? I can't believe I'm writing that check. Because I don't know if it's going clear. The word literally means joyful generosity. You know what God loves? God loves when his people are joyful givers like he is. Do you know that before God ever made the world, God didn't think for one split second about not giving? Because he loved us that much. See, when your love is that great, giving becomes second nature to you. Because it's genuine. And Paul says, I love how he says it. He says, listen, you got to decide in your own heart. And that word decide, in case you didn't know, it has the same ending as the word homicide. Because when you put that word on there, it means to kill or to cut. So homicide is to kill another person. To decide means to kill off decisions. You got to decide in your heart what kind of giver you're going to be. You got to make a decision and say, you know what? I'm not going to be that kind. I'm going to kill that part off. I'm not going to be a reluctant one. I'm not going to be a compulsed one. I'm not going to be a stingy one. I'm going to be a cheerful one. Because God loves that. And the reason why God loves that is because it images him. Because God in his nature is generous, and I want to be like God. So we all have to decide what kind of people we're going to be. Are we going to be generous, cheerful, hilarious givers? Now, you might be wondering why I've got this cell phone signal behind me. Isn't it funny? We laid this out, it was like a chart. But it's like, oh, it looks like signal strength. And if you got AT&T, it's kind of down here. If you got Verizon, it's kind of over here, right? Sorry, was that like offensive? I didn't know. But I want to explain a couple things to you. And I think this chart is really, really helpful. And here's what I want you to do. Give me a few minutes. Because this chart is basically a journey. It's what we call here the generosity journey. I have to make sure I'm spelling this correctly. The word generous, it has a U in it, but then the word generosity, you lose it. That's why it's hard to learn languages sometimes. So this is the generosity journey. And here's what I want you to see. You're somewhere on here. You are somewhere in this, and I'm not, you don't have to raise your hand, you don't have to write a card, you don't have to do all this. I just want you, as I talk through this, to self-select where you are. Because here's the truth. You want like a foundational truth? You can't be what you're not. Like you say, I am this, but if you're not that, then you're not that. That was like way deep. So here's the thing. You can't be what you're not. But by God's grace, you can become what you're not. So you can only start where you are, is my point. You can't start where you're not. But by God's grace, you can take a step. And so here's what I want you to see. Here's the first one. We call this an occasional giver. So an occasional giver. An occasional giver is someone who gives on occasions. And so you might come to church and we had, you know, an occasion, a special offering or something happened. You're like, yeah, I can give. And this person asked themselves this question. How much of my money can I give? How much of my money can I give? So you got 10 bucks in your wallet, you're going to give 10 bucks. If you got 20, you're going to give 20. You got 100, you're going to give 20. Right? Sorry, it's pastor humor. I'll move on because you didn't think that was funny. This is an occasional giver. You give on occasions. Here's the second one. This is what we're going to call an intentional giver. You're now giving with intention. You've now thought about, before you had an opportunity, what you were going to do. So you thought, I'm gonna give with intention. I'm intentionally do this. I'm gonna show up prepared. So it's not about just what I have on me, but this is me asking this question. You ask, how much of my money am I going to give? Not how much of my money can I give, but how much of my money am I going to? I'm preparing in advance for it. And that's a good step. Because anybody who has ever taught financial accountability says you need to know where your money's going. If you don't know where your money's going, you're going to have more month left at the end of money. So you have to treat money with intentionality. Have you realized that George Washington and those dudes don't like to live with you for very long? Right? They make horrible companions because you're like, oh, I'll see you later, buddy. So you have to give with intention. You have to put intentionality to it. You have to think about it beforehand. And that's a great step to take. But that's not the last step. Here's the next step. We call this I'm just going to abbreviate. Sorry. Proportional. I think that's right. If it's not, email Chad, all right? This is proportional giving. This is when you start thinking about your generosity in proportions. You know, anybody who teaches nutrition, it's all about proportion. So much of this, so much of this, so much of this. But you know why a lot of us struggle with food? Because we don't think proportionally. You know, they say the size of a proportion is the size of your fist. Well, that's about the size of my roll, right? Like the size of my meat is, you know, or whatever, potatoes. So you gotta start thinking proportionally. But you know what we've realized? Most people don't think about their finances proportionally. This is when the kind of traditional understanding of a tithe comes in. This is where we talk about percentages. So a proportional giver is someone who starts to look at their finances and their time and their talents through proportion. Where am I giving? To what am I giving to? And how much? And this person has switched in their mind, and here's what they're asking themselves. How much of your money am I going to give? See, this is the person that understands that God's the one who bought the cookie. This is the person that understands that they have what they have because God has been generous to them, and they realize that God has said, I only want you to give back a portion. It would be the equivalent of God saying, here's $10,000, and I only want you to give me back $1,000. You can have the rest. Do you realize every blessing you have is on loan from God? Every one. There's not a one that you have that you got by yourself. You're like, well, I made my money. Yeah, but who made you? Who gave you those lungs? Who gave you that heart? Who gave you that brain? Who gave you that talent? Who gave you that ability? It all comes from God. Just like everything my kids have comes from me, a little bit from their grandparents, right? But this is a person who says, you know what? I'm going to ask God, how much of your money am I going to give? But here's, and let me stop here for a second. Here's where most people in church world stop. I'm giving 10%. Isn't that what God wants? Isn't that what God wants? Wow. That's like my kid saying, isn't that what you want as part of my cookie? What ain't your cookie? It's love. See, it's as you step up to the next level, your love becomes more and more genuine. And so you start thinking proportionally. But do you know in the Old Testament, they had more than one tithe? In fact, if you kind of do the math in the Old Testament, they had two tithes, two 10%ers, and then a 3% offering. So most people in the Old Testament gave 23%. And then Jesus comes along and ups it, calls it being spirit-led, which is really the next two steps. So here's the next step. This is what we call sacrificial giver. Sacrificial. Because honestly, and I don't mean to be mean when I say this, but honestly, until this point, it wasn't really a sacrifice. This is just obedience. This is sacrificial. This is when you say, you know what, I was going to buy a new car, but the one I got is, it runs, it gets me where I need to go. I don't need to go there in style, I just need to get there. And so I'm gonna sacrifice that. I'm gonna forego that. Why? Because I love the Lord. And I love what the Lord is doing on the earth. So I'm gonna be a sacrificial giver. And this is when you start to move beyond 10%. This is when you start to ask this: how much of your money do you want me to give? This is when you ask the Lord, how much of your money, because it's all yours, do you want me to give? You start asking that question, and God will start showing you needs. And this isn't just about giving to the church. This is being a generous person. You start thinking sacrificially. You start thinking, what can I go without so that they can go with? What do I have that I don't really need, that someone else doesn't have and they do need? I'm thinking sacrificially. And here's the last step. Eternal. An eternal giver. Now listen to this question. This is the person who asks, how much of your money do you want me to keep? Not how much do you, I'm not even asking how much you want me to give anymore. Now I'm asking, how much do you want me to keep? One of the pastors that I just love that I think exhibits this in a huge way is a guy by the name of Rick Warren. Now you might disagree with his theology, but here's the one thing you cannot disagree with. You cannot disagree with his generosity. And here's the journey him and his wife went on. When they got married, they were proportional givers. And they decided that every year of their marriage, they would increase it by 1%. Every year. So every year they would increase it 11%, 12%, 13%, 14%, all the way up. To where he was hitting about 40% of his income was going out to the church and everywhere else. And God richly blessed him. And he wrote the second best-selling book of all time, only next to the Bible, called Purpose Driven Life. You may have heard of it. And you know what Rick did when he got that book? First, he wrote a check back to his church for 25 years worth of salary that they had paid him. 25 years, wrote a check back to the church. The second thing that he did was he no longer took a salary from the church anymore. The third thing that he did was he started giving away 90% of his income and living on 10. And I've been to his house and I've seen the car he drives. He still drove the same beat up Ford Expedition. Why? Because he's an eternal giver. He realizes that he can send his money ahead of him. He can invest in the kingdom that is to come. And that's the generosity journey. And here's what I'm saying to you. You got to decide. You got to make a decision. What kind of giver will you be? And my argument is, when you take another step, you're becoming more and more of a cheerful giver. More and more of a cheerful giver, more and more like God. Let me give you a couple more verses and then we're done. Back to 2 Corinthians chapter 9. Just in case you're like, I hear you, Jason. I mean, that's a great chart. But you don't know my circumstance. You don't know my life. You don't know where I've been. Just in case that was your thought, let me leave you with these verses. Verse 8, and God is able. God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that having all sufficiency in all things at all times, you may abound in every good work. It's almost like God wanted to know he got you. It's almost like God saying, you can trust me. Because here's the deal. When grace works itself out in you and you become more generous, God has a tendency to give you more grace. He has a tendency to make more grace abound to you so that you'll have sufficiency in all things at all times so that you can be generous in every good work. Verse 9, as it is written, he has distributed freely. He has given to the poor. His righteousness endures forever. Verse 10 and 11, he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will supply and multiply. We're going to do a series in January called Multiply because God is a multiplying kind of God. To multiply your seed for sowing and increase the harvest of your righteousness. Look at verse 11. You will be enriched in every way. You know what that word enriched means? Look at the root of it. Rich. You'll be rich in every way. Now, for the sake of heresy, let me just say to you, I'm not saying you give God 100, they're going to be 1,000. I'm not saying give so that you can receive. That's not what I'm saying. If that's your motivation, then just don't do it. But here's what I am saying. When you give, you'll be made rich in every way. Not just in your bank account, but I've never met a generous person who had need. Because God has a unique way of meeting those needs. But you'll be enriched in every way. Your faith, your speech, your knowledge, your love. God is a multiplying God. Anything that you give, God will multiply back to you. I promise you. See, here's the thing, to be generous in every way, which through us will produce thanksgiving to God. You know how I know this? I've seen it happen in my own life, but I've seen it happen here in the life of our church. When I first got here in 2010, about 2 months before that, about six months before that, our church's founding pastor had left. And it really left the church in a devastating situation. Really, really tough. And if you were here, you remember that. Remember back at the conference center and everything that happened during that time? And when I first came, our church, about 2 months before I came, barely had $5,000 in the bank account, and we could hardly make payroll. And when I got here about 3 or 4 months in, one day I was preaching on giving. And I was having a conversation with people and I was talking about proportional giving, tithing. And one of my friends, who we were early on in our relationship, came up to me and he said, hey, Jason, since you're challenging the church to give, why don't you take the challenge for the church? And about at that time, our church was giving about 3% of our budget away to missions outside the church. He said, if you're gonna challenge the church to do it, why don't you do it? And I was like, oh, you're so right. I hadn't even considered that yet. So that was the day that our church began to tithe. I rounded up our elders real quick, like in between services, like, you good with this? You good with this? You good with this? Okay, folks, we'll get the minutes later. And that day we made a decision to start tithing as a church, to give. And you know what happened? It set our church off on a generosity journey to where that fall, we did a giving initiative called Advance and we raised $2.7 million over a 3-year period. And this was a church who couldn't make payroll 10 months earlier. And then we bought this land. And then we built this building. And then we expanded this building. Then we built the kids' building. And then we've done the parking lot multiple times. But you know, this year, we were able to pay cash for that parking lot. Pay cash for it. And you guys gave. We had a one day of giving. You gave $400,000 in one day, one Sunday. Our goal was 200. And God just kind of multiplied it by two. Man, I get excited, I get ghetto, so don't worry about it, all right? And now we're able to remodel our offices. We're going to move our offices out, remodel all of our offices for kids' space, and we get to pay for that in cash. And then 3 weeks ago, check this, 3 weeks ago, on a Friday afternoon, Chad and I and David Johnson, our realtor here, walked into a closing in Jasper where we were able to pay cash for another property in Jasper. Yeah. And you know what's amazing when you pay cash for something? The loan docs are like that big. I mean, like the closing docs are like that big. Because you don't have a loan. Like we walked in there and we signed it and David's like, it's amazing what happens when you got money. You're right. Like, signed six pages, we were done in 15 minutes. Got a free koozie, it was awesome. Now hear me. This is a church who 7 years ago, this month, barely had $5,000 in its bank account and couldn't hardly make payroll. But we decided to trust God. To say, God, we're going to be a generous church. And we've been on this journey. And you know what happens? You know when you become a cheerful giver? You know what happens to you? You want more of it. We hit 1,000 people got saved this year. You know how many people have been saved in the last 7 years here at our church? 2,224. Over 2,000 people have trusted Christ in the last 7 years. Last weekend, when we crossed over the 1,000 number, you know what also happened last weekend? Because of a lot of generosity in this church, we met our budget goal for the year last weekend. Almost 2 months early. That don't happen. But you know why it happens? Because God loves a cheerful giver. And he is able to make all grace abound so that when you sow that seed, he will multiply that seed and you'll be enriched in every way so that you can be generous in every way. Why? Because God is generous in every way. And when you see that and you know that and it hits you, you no longer give under compulsion. You no longer give reluctantly. You give hilariously. And so here's all I'm saying to you. As a church, we took these steps. And I want you to take these steps. Why? Because the more you take these steps, the more you are like God. And the more you are like God, the more God blesses you. See, if you just hang down here an occasional giver, God will occasionally bless you. You move up into an intentional giver, God will intentionally bless you. You move up to a proportional giver, God will proportionately bless you. You move up to a sacrificial giver, God will sacrificially bless you. You move up to an eternal giver, and God will bless you for all eternity. You see what I'm saying? And so I want you to hear me. Don't leave today and be like, what was church about? Pastor talking about money. I knew I shouldn't have come today. I should have been in the deer stand. If that's what you've heard, you haven't heard my heart. You haven't heard the Holy Spirit.